Well, church, let's open our Bibles this morning. John chapter 15. We're going to be finishing that chapter. Kind of a shift in gears this morning. John is recording the words of Jesus here, giving his followers instruction in times of persecution. While you're turning there, let me pray. Father, we do love you, and it's a privilege to sing about the great things that Jesus has done on our behalf. But we know that comes with a calling, God. A calling to stand as salt and light. A calling to profess truth. To proclaim the gospel. And in the midst of that activity, you have promised us that as you suffered, we will too. As you were persecuted, so too we will fall under the world's persecution. So Father, I pray for Cornerstone this morning that they would hear the encouragement of our Father as we face different forms and shades of persecution, cultural pressure, tension in families, difficult situations at school and in the workplace. And we question, how bold do we make our stand? We face the temptation to fall into the shadows, to get out of the light. But God, you've sent our spirit that we would be overcomers, more than conquerors. You've given us your spirit that he would be our backbone of steel to stand against impossible pressure, even death for some of the saints around the world. So God, we pray for an encouraging word this morning to help us stand, that we would bring you glory, and that we would do it with joy. Refresh our souls this morning, we pray this in Jesus' name, amen. John chapter 15, starting in verse 18, we're going to finish the second half of this chapter. How many of you, by show of hands, have heard of the ministry Voice of the Martyrs? Anybody familiar with what that is? A lot of you in here. How about any of you get their magazines or a part of their ministry? A few of you in here. My wife is a faithful subscriber to their magazine, and it's one of her favorite missions, and she always passes on the magazines for me to read, and this last week I read about Pastor Han. Pastor Han was called into full-time ministry in China. And in China, he was placed in an area right next to the border of North Korea. Now, it was not his intent to minister to North Koreans. He had just settled in a town to minister to the Chinese population there. But the border was weak in this area. The guards were relaxed, and there was traffic back and forth between the Chinese and the North Koreans. The North Koreans would cross the border. They would be starving and naked. And they found that buildings with crosses on them would provide help, would give them clothes, would give them food. Pastor Hans was one of those places. So as they began to develop a relationship with him, he felt that he could not turn his back on them. And what began to happen is he would train them, he would feed them, he would clothe them. All these different things would begin to happen. They'd develop that relationship. He'd share the gospel, and everything would start to fit together in a way that they began their relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. But here's where it got difficult. For Pastor Han, he didn't play this game easy. He would look at them after receiving the gospel, after training them, and say, now you cannot defect to South Korea. You cannot blend into China. Your people are living in darkness back in North Korea, and you've got to go there. You've got to bring them to life. And this is a death sentence, to go back to North Korea with the gospel. But they would do that, and he had a faithful ministry where they would strategize different ways. They would send balloons over, and they just have all kinds of neat ways that they were actually working with Voice of the Martyrs. Well, eventually, the North Koreans and the Chinese government kind of got wind of what was happening here. And they weren't sure exactly how it happened, but the suspicion is that North Korea sent over a defector on purpose to find him and to pretend that he was in need and to pretend that he was a Christian and to pretend to be a disciple. And they found Pastor Han's body a while later, and it had been he had been killed, a stab to the heart, a slit to the throat, many stabs to the head. It mirrored an assassin from North Korea. The question becomes this: what would drive someone to put their lives in that kind of danger for the sake of the gospel? Why not lay a little bit more low than that? Pastor Han knew his life was in danger. His wife was in danger. His children were in danger. What pushes people to go this far with their witness, especially when we compare our witness here to America? And so many Christians struggle where we feel the cultural pressures, where our lives may not be endangered, but our jobs or our social respect, we're afraid of being labeled, and there's pressure in the family, there's pressure at school, there's pressure on the job, and just awkward situations, and the media coming down in all different forms, and it just seems like Christians especially are under fire. This is what I want you to understand this morning, Christians, is we ought not to be shocked when this culture turns against us. Jesus promised that that would happen. And he does not want his followers to be disheartened. Let me begin reading in verse 18 in this first section. And this is talking about persecution coming because of separation. We are separate from the world. And this is our theme today. When we share in Christ's suffering, we're going to share in his glory. So listen to verse 18. If the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. The world hates Christians because of their link with Jesus. The world will hate you because of your link with Jesus Christ. It's not the people who are the enemy. Do you remember this from Ephesians 6? Paul says it's not flesh and blood. It's powers and principalities in high places. The battle is a spiritual one. It is the forces of darkness. But God gives us this promise. In 1 John 4:4, we're told, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. The source of the animosity that is coming against the kingdom of God is not stronger than the source of power that resides in you as a Christian. Therefore, you need not be intimidated. You need not back down. Persecution comes because of our separation from the world. We are no longer of the world. Let me make this clear, Christians. When you are saved, you have no say-so over your life anymore. You do not belong to yourself. You've been purchased with a price, and now your life belongs to God. You're under new management. You have given yourself away. You don't have a say-so over your life anymore. God now lives within you, and we're going to learn from this passage, the Holy Spirit's desire is to proclaim Jesus, and we can't run from that. We can't dodge that. We can't hide from that or back away from that, but the spiritual war will try to suppress our witness with all of its might. The kingdom of darkness does not want the light getting out. God tells us this in Jesus' words. He says, I chose you out of this world. Christians, you need to take great comfort in that. Out of this dark world, God specifically has chosen you and appointed you to be a spokesman for him, to be a light of his kingdom, to be an ambassador. And with that, he has full intentions of equipping you with everything that is necessary to accomplish what he has purposed for your life. Early on in my ministry, I read a couple of verses out of the Old Testament from Isaiah 41, verses 9 and 10. And I don't know how to explain it, but I mean, God was speaking right to my heart with these verses. He wanted me to get this. He wanted me to know that this was for me. And I needed to hear it, and it marked my ministry. And Isaiah 41 says this, you whom I have chosen, you whom I've taken from the ends of the earth and taken from its remotest parts, you are my servant. I have chosen you. I have not rejected you. I am your God. Do not be afraid. Do not look anxiously about, for I am with you. I will strengthen you. Surely I will help you. Surely I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. God wanted me to know early in my ministry that I wasn't here by coincidence, that he had singled me out for this purpose, for this specific call. He wanted me to know that. Jesus, in his words to the disciples, to you here this morning, Cornerstone, wants you to hear the words loud and clear, I chose you for this. I have chosen you. I will empower you. I will walk beside you. But this discipleship, church, will cost you. There is a cost to following Jesus. Because we are not a part of this world, we should not anticipate or expect the world's affections. It should not shock us when we listen to talk shows in different sources of media and we are scratching our heads. Well, why is it Christians that are always under fire? Why is it Christians that are being marked out as being hateful and angry and intolerant and bigoted? Why does the media pick the worst case scenarios of Christians in the filthiest of situations and horrible judgment? Why do they pick them and display them as though that represents all Christians? It should not shock us. Jesus said, they hated me, they'll hate you. In fact, in the next section, he's going to tell us, verse 20, remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you. If they kept my word, they will also keep yours. But all these things they will do to you on account of my name, because they do not know him that sent me. You know, Christians, every one of us at some point or another are going to have to lean on those two verses. We're going to have to be reminded, they are persecuting me because of Jesus. This is what this is about. The world, the darkness in this world is after Jesus. The hatred, the animosity, it started there. And now that I'm reflecting Jesus, the world is now after me too. Jesus says, they persecuted me, they'll persecute you also. I do want to read to you 1 Peter chapter 4 just very quickly. 1 Peter 4 says this, verse 12, beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you, but rejoice in so far as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. This reflects Romans chapter 8, 17 and 18. It tells us that we must share in his sufferings in order to share in his glory. And Paul says, I consider that our current sufferings will not compare to the future glory that will be revealed in us. It's part of God's plan that through our suffering, he will be glorified. So he says, I don't want you to be surprised at that fiery trial when it comes. Verse 14, if you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. When you're persecuted for the name of Jesus, students in school, adults in the workplace, family members, when this stuff is going on, we are called blessed. We are blessed by God because the Spirit of God living within us is drawing the fire of the enemy here on earth. Matthew 5:10 in the Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes. He says there, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We are to count it a joy when we are persecuted for Jesus. He suffered greatly for us. It is a privilege to suffer for him. Verse 15, but let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or as a meddler. We'll talk more about that later. In other words, if you're suffering on your own account, well, then don't be joyful. If you're bringing hardship upon yourself, you're not doing anybody any favors. You have no reason to be called blessed. Verse 16, yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name. That's an important command. If you are suffering because you are a Christian, you ought not to be ashamed. If someone is labeling you unfairly, judging you unfairly, twisting words in your mouth, you don't have to feel shame because you are suffering for the sake of Jesus. And you need to hear him say, you are blessed for that. You are sharing in my suffering. You will share in my glory. Be encouraged when you suffer for the sake of standing for Jesus. Now, we're going to go through different sections here. So this first section, we'll go through four different ones. This first one was, we are persecuted because we are separated from the world. We do not belong to the world. This next section is going to talk about our being persecuted because of our proclamation of the gospel. Back to John 15. We are persecuted because of our proclamation. Jesus was persecuted because he called sin, sin, and he spread the good news of the gospel. He called sin what it was, rebellion against God, and then he gave the antidote in truth and grace of how people could find God because of their sin. Let me read verses 22-25. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not have been guilty of sin, but now they have no excuses for their sin. Whoever hates me hates my Father also. If I had not done among them the works that no one else did, they would not be guilty of sin. But now they have seen and hated both me and my Father. But the word that was written in their law must be fulfilled. They hated me without a cause. Some of those words can be a little bit confusing. As you're reading that, it almost sounds like what Jesus is saying is, if I hadn't presented the gospel, then they would not be guilty of their sin, as though they existed in some kind of sinless perfection until they're made aware of their sin. Let's put that whole teaching together. Jesus is actually commenting here about degrees of light. Degrees of light. Let me walk you through that very quickly. Romans chapter 1, verse 18 says this, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them, for his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world and the things that have been made, so they are without excuse." Romans chapter 1 says just God has made his presence known enough in creation alone to hold every single person accountable to the truth that we have rebelled against God. A hard truth for this world to swallow is that if God never sent Jesus, he would be completely justified in condemning every single person on earth from beginning of time to the last person to live to an eternity without him because they are guilty of rebelling against God. God didn't have to save anybody. And he would not be unfair or unjust, but it was his love that compelled him to make a way out of that death sentence. This is why Jesus came and he gave an opportunity for us to respond to light, and he bore the penalty of our sin for us. Romans 3:23 says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So just understand, it depends on the degree of light that will impact our judgment. In a couple other places, Jesus speaks about this. I'm just going to read them briefly to you. Matthew chapter 10 is one of those places. He's talking to his disciples, telling them, sending them out two by two, wants you to go into the different towns, and this was their instruction. If anyone will not receive you or listen to your words, shake the dust off your feet when you leave that house or town. Truly I say to you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. Now it's well known that Sodom and Gomorrah was severely judged by God for their wickedness and will stand in judgment on judgment day for that. But they didn't have the degree of light given to these cities around Galilee where the disciples were ministering and explaining the gospel. And Jesus says, when someone hears the gospel, rejects it so that they can continue in their sin, the degree of light that they have been exposed to is much higher, and their judgment will be much more severe. They bring it upon themselves, the consequences of the fullness of their sin. And then Jesus pronounces this himself in the next chapter, chapter 11, verse 20 of Matthew. Then he began to denounce the cities where most of his mighty works had been done because they did not repent. And he says, woe to you, to the different cities. Woe to you, Bethsaida. For if the mighty works done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I tell you, it will be more bearable in the day of judgment for Tyre and Sidon than for you. And Tyre and Sidon were very proud cities in the Old Testament, very wicked cities. And you, Capernaum, he says, will you be exalted to heaven? You will be brought down to Hades. For if the mighty works done in you had been done in Sodom, it would have remained until this day. But I tell you that it will be more tolerable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom than for you. The greater the light rejected, the greater the judgment. And that's what Jesus is teaching here. So that needs to be clear as we're reading in John chapter 15. Jesus is talking about these degrees of light. Now, verse 24, Jesus talks about their hate for him. They would not be guilty of sin, but now they have seen and hated both me and my Father, but the word that is written in their law must be fulfilled. They persecute me without cause. Jesus is making note here that if he had not proclaimed the Father's message, he would not have suffered the way that he did. He could have gotten along very well in the world. But as he judged sin, called it what it was, as he brought the kingdom message with him, it brought a heavy penalty, great persecution. He crossed the line that brings persecution in this world. And Christians, so will your witness. Your witness will bring persecution. The temptation then for you will be to not witness, not testify about Jesus. It's kind of like that, the stimulus and a response. When I do this, when I profess Jesus, I feel tension, I feel pushback, so I don't want to do that. Jesus is telling us, no, do that. I'll make you fishers of men, and I'll give you the Spirit to strengthen you and to stand firm during the times of persecution. And when the persecution comes, you know what? Don't be intimidated. Count it all joy. You're suffering for me, just like I suffered for you, and that will be your reward, and I'll receive the glory. Jim Elliot, a mighty missionary who died for his faith, so he said that we are harmless because we are unharmed. We are harmless, therefore unharmed. In other words, we're not engaging in the spiritual battle. We're these spiritual pacifists. We're non-militants, conscientious objectors in this battle to the death with principalities and powers in high places. He says we're not engaging the enemy, and therefore there's no harm in our battle, but that's not the way God designed us. He designed us to be conquerors, warriors, to speak out truth and light, to stand firm against the persecution. We as Christians have learned to back into the shadows and do what our government tells us, or our employers tell us, or the teachers tell us, and then we play by those rules. But I want to encourage you, Christians. God says, get out there, be the salt and light. Don't be obnoxious, be gracious with your words, but stand firm. And when the persecution comes, that is honor to the Lord. You are to take joy. It says here, Jesus says that they hated me without cause. I want to go back to 2 Peter. I told you I was going back there at one point. So this is what 2 Peter says. For what credit is it when you sin and are beaten for it and you endure? All right, coming back to this idea, Christians, just because you're suffering doesn't mean you're suffering for the right cause. If you deserve it, if you bring it on yourself, there's no joy in this. But if when you do good and suffer for it, you endure, this is a gracious thing in the sight of God. For to you, this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you might follow in his steps. Hear that, church. You have been called to suffer like Jesus suffered. You have been called to walk the line that will bring persecution as you testify of the truth. Now, as you're proclaiming Jesus, you better have a life that backs that up. That doesn't mean sinlessness. That doesn't mean perfection. But you have a true heart for God. You're living for him. That's why Peter throws in here, look, if you're behaving badly and that's why you're suffering, you have nothing to be joyful about. But if it's because you're a Christian and your love for Christ compels you to testify of him, then you have reason to rejoice. Jesus never intended to give comfort to a Christian who is hated by the world because they're selfish and overly judgmental and conceited and easily offended. He didn't say these words to give comfort to Christians who are mean and unsympathetic and lazy and joyless and judging the motives of others and quick-tempered and they're just bringing bad cards to the table. Jesus isn't trying to comfort them. Those Christians have some repenting to do. All right, so two times in Peter, he makes that distinction. Christians, if it's your love for Christ that makes you suffer, take joy. If it's your own lousy behavior, if you're just an unlikable person, then you have nothing to be joyful about here. Persecution in Christ for the right reasons bring great power because it activates the Spirit within us. All right, so those are two sections here. The first section, persecution comes because we're separated from the world. We no longer belong to the world. We're not going to experience the world's affections. We belong to the Father. We're the kingdom. We're citizens of the kingdom of heaven. Section two, persecution comes because of our proclamation of Jesus Christ in the gospel. Now, the last two sections here. Section three, the Holy Spirit empowers us to proclaim Jesus. Here's why we need that. Understand, when we get that persecution is brought on by our proclamation, the temptation is to close our mouth, to silence the witness. We don't want to experience that discomfort. But God sends us the Holy Spirit to help us break through that so that we don't get stuck in our Christian walk. Verses 26 and 27, listen to this. But when the Helper comes, we know who the Helper is. The Parakletos, that's a word for the Holy Spirit, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father. Underline this in your Bible in verse 26. He will bear witness about me. Now, how's he going to do that? The Spirit comes, and we are his temple. He abides in us. Now, how do you think, from this position, he is going to bear witness about Jesus Christ? Christian, it's through you. It's the desire of the Spirit that will push you through the resistance of the culture and the world in which you live to continue to speak truth about Christ, even though it brings persecution. The Spirit will want it. Remember, you are saved. You're no longer your own. It's not your interests you're worried about. You've given yourself away. Your purpose is now to bring glory to God, no matter the cost, and we take joy when that happens. The Holy Spirit becomes the backbone of the Christian to stand in times of persecution. He will bear witness about me. Verse 27, and you also will bear witness. You work together because you have been with me from the beginning. The chief work of the Holy Spirit is to proclaim Jesus. And Jesus has already told us, Matthew 4:19, that he's going to make us fishers of men. We're going to cooperate in this together. We are called to cooperate with him. Now watch what happens in the New Testament when the Holy Spirit comes. Remember Peter, when he came under fire, Jesus was headed to the cross. A little girl identifies him, says, you're a disciple. And he starts cussing and swearing to say, no, I'm not one of those disciples. You're wrong. He was completely overcome by fear. He feared the persecution. But then the Holy Spirit comes. And we get a whole new Peter. We get a whole new John. Acts chapter 4, 10, 11, 12, Peter gets out in front of the very people who crucified Jesus. And he says, let it be known by you and by all of Israel that it is by Jesus Christ of Nazareth that this man stands here before you healed. And you have rejected the stone you builders have, which has now become the capstone, the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Peter just starts proclaiming the gospel in the face of a hostile crowd. What's the difference? That Holy Spirit has become his backbone. and the Holy Spirit has become his desire. He doesn't care what happens. In fact, Jesus has already told Peter at his death, we'll get there at the end of this book in John, Peter, you're going to be killed like I'm killed, only worse. You're going to be drug off in a way where you don't want to be drug, and you're going to be slaughtered in a way that you don't want to be slaughtered. It's a bad deal for Peter. He knows that's coming. Jesus predicted his death. He doesn't care. He gets up in front of the same crowd, and he preaches Jesus. And you know what happens? 3,000 of them get saved. That's how the Holy Spirit, God is honored when his people walk in boldness and proclaim the truth of Jesus. How about Paul in 1 Corinthians 9:16? Woe is me if I do not preach the gospel. Paul can't even fathom his life without preaching the gospel. Can't even picture that. Woe is me. God, just take me home now if I'm not going to preach the gospel. People, we have to develop that heart. We have to run after him. We have to have a heart that does not shrink back when the culture begins to push back on us. They don't want us to proclaim Jesus. Well, of course not. This world belongs to a prince of darkness. But we are ambassadors of the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of light, the kingdom of life. And we are going to proclaim that because this lost world needs it. Just like Pastor Han on the border of North Korea said, you've got to go back into the darkness and you've got to proclaim the light, because if you don't, who else will? In the same way, we as citizens of heaven are being sent back out to the slaughter. Proclaim Jesus, because if you don't, who will to your family? Who will to your coworkers? Who will to your baseball team? Who will to your classmates? If you won't, who will? We have the responsibility to go back. And Christians, there is nothing honoring about a Christian who is in darkness, who simply remains silent to avoid the persecution. The enemy is tripping you up. That's not how we're to live. Jesus says, you know what? Step out in faith. You might get persecuted, but it's okay. Take joy when it happens. You're suffering for me as I have suffered for you. You count that a privilege to suffer for me. Remember what happened in John chapter 9? Blind man healed by Jesus. He starts to tell people, hey, all I know is I was blind. I met Jesus. Now I can see. Kicked him out of the synagogue. Immediate persecution when you connect it to the name of Jesus. There will be a cost for following Jesus. But don't let that intimidate you. That cost will reap rewards for your eternity. And it will bring God glory. So, section 1, persecution comes because of our separation from the world. Section 2 talked about persecution coming because of our proclamation of Jesus Christ. Section 3 now speaks about the Holy Spirit empowering us to proclaim Jesus despite that persecution. Our last section, the four verses here, the first four verses of chapter 16, the Holy Spirit will empower us to stand when our hour comes. All through the book of John, Jesus was talking about his hour, his time of testing. Now he starts talking about his disciples' hour. Just as Jesus had his, we will have ours. Let me read verse 1. I have said all these things to you to keep you from falling away. Now that's loaded language. What does that mean? Now this is in the context of the hour. Indeed, the hour is coming, it says in verse 2. I've said all these things to you to keep you from falling away. Well, John, the exact same author in 1 John chapter 2, clarifies and expands on this, so I'm going to let him explain himself. 1 John 2:18-19 says this, children, it is the last hour. He's talking about the exact same thing here. And as you have heard that Antichrist is coming, so now many Antichrists have come. Therefore, we know that this is the last hour. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would not have continued with us. They would have continued with us. But they went out that it might become plain that they are not of us. But you have been anointed with the Holy One. What he's clarifying here. He's saying that those who have fallen away, those who have walked away, they have done so that it might be clear that they were never one of them. The classic example is Judas. Judas was with the 12 disciples, But we see as we monitor his life, we look at his actions, his motives are made clear throughout the Gospels. He was never one of them. And sure enough, he fell away. There was no power internally made available to him through his faith in Jesus Christ. He was just Christian on the outside. Now, I will make this statement. These can be highly debated words and how all this plays out according to your background in theology. Here's what I want to make. I want to make this very plain. No matter if you think that this is a case of someone losing their salvation, or if you think of someone this is a case of someone who was never saved, by the time you get to this person, we're all in agreement, they ain't saved. Okay? This person, you don't want to be the guy, the girl that falls away. You don't want to be the person that abandons Jesus. Now, I believe it's very clear here in this teaching that the reason they fell away is because they were never one of them, and that's the reason their faith was tested. God is faithful to keep us, but false faith will always be exposed, as will genuine faith. Because in this spiritual battle, both Satan and God have one objective they share. They want to expose your faith for what it really is. If it's the false one, Satan wants to make sure that's exposed. That's to his glory. If it's the real deal, God will allow it to be exposed, because that's to his glory. Our faith will be tested, tried, and exposed in this life. When that hour comes, God is very interested in making sure you succeed, that your faith is found genuine. So listen, I have said these things, John 16, to keep you from falling away. Verse 2, that they will put you out of the synagogue, like John chapter 9, the blind man. Indeed, the hour is coming when whoever kills you will think he is offering service to God. We see that all around the globe right now. You know, I heard a statistic. I believe it was from the Voice of the Martyrs, but I can't quote them because I don't know if that's exactly where it was. But in 2016 alone, more Christians have been martyred and killed for their faith than all the rest of history put together. That's crazy. The hour is here. The hour is coming. When whoever kills you will think he is offering service to God, and they will do those things because they have not known the Father nor me. Verse 4, but I have said these things to you, that when their hour comes, you may remember that I have told them to you. This is where Jesus is going with this. Will you stand for Christ when your hour comes, when the pressure is on? When you're in the school classroom, when you're sitting in a college room and the professor's beaten down on people who believe in Jesus, and how stupid do you have to be? When your employees are hammering you and labeling you as a hater and a bigot, and your boss is coming down on you. When you have that relative who just won't leave you alone and getting under your skin and you just don't want to talk about it anymore. Will you stand when your hour comes? Christians, embrace the persecution that comes when you stand for Jesus. Don't be afraid of it. Don't be intimidated to be quiet, to fade into the shadows. Jesus says, count it joy to suffer for me. It was my joy to suffer for you. As you share in my sufferings, you will also share in my glory. Do not be intimidated. Do not be afraid. Allow my Holy Spirit, who resides within you, to be your backbone so that you can have boldness and engage the culture which I have chosen you to be in at this time, a witness for me. When our hours come, we have to stand. And here's the thing, church. You have to decide that and be confident in that before you get there. You need to know leaving this place today that when the time of testing comes, when the false accusations come, when the names and the labels are being assigned to you, that you will not back down, that you will not cave. Jesus Christ is the only hope of salvation in this world. Never back down from that. Don't be arrogant about it. Don't be a jerk about it. Be humble, be gracious, but never back down. It was Jesus Christ who saved your soul, and it's Jesus Christ who can save anyone who will come to him through the cross if they would only repent of their sin. and embrace him, accept his forgiveness, and place their faith and trust in him alone for their eternal salvation. These are the fundamentals, Christians, that we just can't bend on. We can't back away from. There is tremendous pressure in this culture and in this world for us to be silent about these matters. You can talk about it in these four walls, but when you go back out there, we're supposed to hush. Don't hush. Let us be found faithful and proclaim Jesus Christ the best way that you can. And every time you do it, it's going to require faith. And know that the Holy Spirit has been given to you for just that purpose. I can tell you as a pastor, I've had many, 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 many opportunities to witness to people. And every time I get to the point in talking about Jesus where I want to offer to them the option for them to accept, to receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, there is always the pressure and the temptation to just kind of leave that in their court. To, you know, there's always the first hurdle to even bring Jesus up. It's getting there. And then once you're there, there's another hurdle about, hey, you need to receive him. You need to repent of your sin. God loves you. He wants you to put this whole package together. And every time you do that, there's always the temptation that, well, here's all the information, and I hope you go make a good choice with that. But God has called us to engage the people of this world who are searching for God. They just don't know how to find him. They don't know what this is about. And they need people of light with boldness to come alongside them and say, let me walk you right through this. Some people will reject the message. And Jesus says, look, that's on them. But some people will receive the message. And that's our joy. But the only way for you to partake in that spiritual battle is if you proclaim, if you open your mouth, if you become bold, and the Holy Spirit has been given to you, that you would be successful in that, that you would take those steps of faith. This is the Lord's heart's desire, that this would be done throughout this church family. Let's pray for God to use us this week for his glory at our expense, and we'll take joy as we suffer for Christ, and we will rejoice as we see victories as we engage in spiritual battle. Church, let's pray. Father, we love you and we thank you for the encouragement from John 15, just hearing the heart of Jesus talk to our family this morning, saying, family, you're going to suffer for my name, but count it joy. Father, make us a bold family here at Cornerstone, that we would not be intimidated into silence, that we would not be intimidated back into the shadows to blend in with this world. But Father, let us follow Jesus, our King, who would not blend in, but who was outspoken about sin and the gospel, and yet his love permeated everything that he did, and he was so out of place in this world that they crucified him. Father, don't let us get comfortable. It's okay for us to be out of place. We're citizens of heaven, not citizens of earth. The world is not going to love us. They're not going to like us. But God, you have sent us here into battle that we would proclaim with confidence the truth of the gospel. And as we are obedient, Father, we are going to see people cross the line from darkness into light. God, with all of our hearts, we want to be used that way, but in our flesh, we are so weak. Our spirits are willing with the same struggle that the disciples had. God, so fill us with your Spirit this morning that we would be united with him in mission and mind and spirit, that his desire to proclaim Jesus would become our desire to proclaim Jesus, that his boldness for the gospel would become our boldness for the gospel, that we would resemble the disciples of the New Testament church when they went out and proclaimed the gospel. Father, let us be silent no more. There is a harvest here, and the laborers are few. Wake up the laborers, God. Stir the spirit within us. Let us this week suffer for Jesus, for your glory at our expense. We ask you to do that, God, and we'll take joy. But give us the victories. Let us see the lives that are changed. Let us see the souls that go from darkness to light. Let us take part in the joy of those victories, God. And as we come back together week after week, let this be a sweet place where our batteries are recharged. We encourage one another, that we heal from our wounds of spiritual battle, and we go back out for another week to bring you glory. Father, engage this army here at Cornerstone. We want to have an impact for you. Before I close this time of prayer, I want to talk to our friends that are here this morning. Maybe you're listening to all of this, and you can feel the Spirit of God speaking to your heart. You need to take your first initial step, accepting Jesus Christ as your Savior. And as you listen to the words that are spoken this morning, you're counting the cost. That's a scary commitment to make. And you should count the cost. But you should know as you respond to the gospel that you are giving your life away into the hands of a God who loves you and who is powerful, who has a plan for your life, who can bring order and protection and purpose and fulfillment. He calls it the abundant life. Some of you need to come on board this morning. And if you can feel the Spirit of God working in your heart right now, you know that you need to come to God. You need to have your sins forgiven. You need to become a part of the family of God. You need to place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ alone. You need to let go of this life. You're not in control anyway. And you need to give this over to God. If that's where you're at this morning, I want to give you the opportunity to acknowledge that before God, that first step of faith, with no one looking around here this morning. If that's where you're at, would you place your hand high in the air for me to see? I will not point you out or embarrass you, but you need to acknowledge before God, God, this is where I'm at, and I hear you. Anyone here this morning, is that where you're at? Would you just raise your hand in the air for me to see? Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Anyone else? This is important that you respond if God is working in your heart. If he's calling your name right now, would you just place your hand in the air for me to see? I won't embarrass you, but you need to acknowledge. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. You need to acknowledge before God, I hear you. Anyone else? I don't want to leave you out this morning. Three people raised their hands, so let me talk to these three people. The gospel is so simple. God loves you. Your sin has separated you from him. Jesus Christ bore that sin on the cross and offers you forgiveness. If only you'll place your faith and trust in him alone for your salvation. If you would like to become part of the family of God, if you would like to sign up for the life that you heard this morning, despite the difficulties, knowing that you're placing your faith and your soul in the hands of a God who loves you. If you're in that place this morning, I just want to lead you through a prayer of salvation. There's no words that will save your soul, but it's the cry of the heart, the Bible says. Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. In this moment, if you are ready to call on Jesus Christ as your Savior, from your heart, would you pray a prayer like this? God, I confess to you that I am a sinner, and I have sinned against you. And I ask you to forgive me. I ask you to wash it all away. I believe that Jesus died my death on that cross. He paid my penalty for my sin so that I could be forgiven. And right now in this moment, I entrust my soul to him. I give myself away. I am purchased by his blood, and I belong to him alone. Thank you for forgiving me. Thank you for saving my soul. From this day forward, I will live for you alone. With no one looking around, if you just prayed that prayer, would you put your hand high in the air to acknowledge before God that you've just placed your faith and trust? Thank you. Two hands going up. Anyone else here this morning? We rejoice with you. We rejoice with you. Christians, this is the spiritual battle that we are engaged in. When we leave this place today, opportunity to invest into the lives of others, as we've just seen here this morning, will be made available to us. So Father, as we leave this place, we ask again, would you give us the boldness? Would you teach us the words to say? Would you help us to walk in faith so that you would receive the glory? Would you help us to stand firm against persecution and pressure in this culture? Let us shine brightly for you. Let us be filled with the Spirit, Father. You'll receive the glory. We're grateful to be your servants, your children. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Would you stand your feet?